2 Kings chapter 4, let's read verses 1 through 7. And it says, "A certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elisha and said, 'Your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant feared the Lord, and the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slaves.' So Elisha said to her, 'What shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in the house?' And she said, 'Your maidservant has nothing in the house but a jar of oil.' Then he said, 'Go borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors, empty vessels. Do not gather just a few. And when you have come in, you shall shut the door behind you, you and your sons, and then pour into all those vessels and set aside the full ones.' So she went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it out. Now it came to pass when the vessels were full that she said to her son, 'Bring me another vessel.' And he said to her, 'There is not another vessel.' So the oil ceased. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, 'Go sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons live on the rest.'" I want to preach to you this morning this thought: what's in your house? What's in your house? Will you pray for me? Lord, I sense, Lord God, your Spirit drawing us, Lord, to encourage us. Lord, giving us a word in season. Father, I pray that you would give ears to hear to your people, to hear what you want to speak to us this morning. In Jesus' name, everyone said amen. What's in your house? The Bible doesn't give us much background about this widow woman in this passage, but we do know that her late husband was one of the prophets, a man who walked with and feared God. However, somehow over the passage of time, this woman incurred a debt of some kind that she was unable to pay. And before she knew it, there was a knock at the door. I'm sure in that moment when the bill collector came to this widow's house, her heart became overwhelmed. She may have even begun to think and to question in her heart and say, "Why, God? My husband was a prophet, a man of God, and now not only am I a widow, but there is a creditor at my door that is going to take my two sons away." Imagine the fear and the feeling of helplessness this woman was feeling in this moment. Not only were these boys all the family she had left, but they were also in that day and age the only ones that would ultimately care for her and provide for her as she grew older. Without them, she would become destitute. So with her heart overwhelmed, this woman sought out the man of God, because she knew that without a miracle from God, that creditor is coming in the morning. So I want us to see four things from this passage this morning that this woman did in her moment of crisis. I want you to hear me. The first thing she did is she admitted her need. Verse 2, she says, "I have nothing but a jar of oil." Listen, it is impossible to fill a full glass. I said it's impossible to fill a full glass. Proverbs 27:7 says, "A satisfied soul loathes the honeycomb, but to a hungry soul every bitter thing is sweet." God won't move in your life, your home, or your church as long as you feel that you are fine without Him. Leonard Ravenhill once said, "The reason we do not have revival is because we are content to live without it." If you do not see your need for God, you will never call out to Him so that He can answer you. Jesus said in His famous Sermon on the Mount, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." In other words, He is saying, blessed are those who realize they are spiritually bankrupt without God. Amen. I have found that the hardest people to get saved are the ones who don't see their need for God. Many times God has to allow crisis into their lives in order for them to come to the end of themselves and finally call out to God. This was the problem with the church at Laodicea in the book of Revelation. Jesus rebuked them in chapter 3, verse 17. He said, "Because you say, 'I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing,' and yet you do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked." See, God can only fill empty things. And the problem is, if we are not hungry for God, that is a sure sign that we are already too full of self. This is the reason that many seek in vain to be filled with, baptized with the Holy Spirit, because God will not fill you with Himself if you are content with being full of yourself. You will never cry out to God till you see how empty you are without him. See, this woman recognized her great need. She recognized she had nothing to offer, nothing in her house. All she had was just a small jar of oil, and it didn't seem like much. But that leads to the second point. Second, she offered the little she had to God. So often we want to see the miracle and then we will believe, but with God, the miracle only happens after we step out in faith. When the children of Israel went to cross the Jordan River, God told those priests carrying the ark to step into the waters, and then they would part, not before. Now they could have stayed on that bank of the river all day praying for the water to part, but until they took that step of faith into the water, nothing happened. And let me tell you, if you've ever seen the Jordan River in Israel, it's not a gradual like the beach going out a little deeper, that there's sections in this Jordan River, and the Bible says it even overflowed when they went, that it was a straight drop. So in other words, God, we have a heavy ark on our shoulders and we're stepping into the water. If you do not part this water, we will drown. So it was a step of faith. They say, God, either you part the water or nothing's going to happen and we will be destroyed by this river. It was a true step of faith. Peter and the disciples that were in the boat during the storm, they see Jesus walking out on the water towards them. Peter cries out, Lord, if it is you, tell me to come to you on the water. Jesus said, come. Peter didn't need to have a prayer meeting in the boat right then to ascertain whether it was the will of God for him to step out of the boat, because God already said, come, it's time to get out of the boat. All Peter needed to do was obey, and as soon as he did, he began to walk on the water to Jesus. Listen, many times it's not so much that we don't know the will of God, it's that we know it, but we won't do it. But God is saying, if you want to see my power, if you want to see my glory, you got to get out of the boat. You got to step out onto the water, and then you will watch the hand of God. Listen, that step of faith is a defining moment in your life. When you seemingly have nothing, but the little you do have, you offer to God in faith. The boy with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And John chapter 6 was willing to give Jesus the little he had. You know, in that little boy's hands, it was enough for him to have a good lunch for the day. But in Jesus' hands, it was enough to feed 5,000 men and their families. Little is much in the hands of God. I said, little is much in the hands of God. God doesn't need much to do much. The Bible says he could take a worm and thrash a mountain. He doesn't need much to do great things through it. All he's looking for is somebody who is willing to say, here, Lord, this is all I have, but I give it into your hands. The Bible says he uses the weak things of this world to confound the things that are mighty, the foolish things of this world to confound those who think they're wise, the things that are not, to bring to nothing those things that are. God doesn't need much. He just needs someone to say, here am I, Lord. Here's the little bit that I have. Take it, use it for your glory. I give it into your hands. Listen, when Peter and John went to pray at the temple after Pentecost, they saw the lame man laying there asking for alms. And Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. Peter didn't have much in the world's eyes, but the little bit he did have was enough to make a lame man walk. Hallelujah. The little bit he had was enough to save 3,000 souls on the day of Pentecost. The little bit he did have was enough for him and his fellow believers to turn the world upside down with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't say, I don't have enough, because the little you have with God is more than enough. Hallelujah. So stop thinking I don't have anything to offer God, and lay down what you do have down at his feet and watch as he takes it, breaks it, and multiplies it for his glory. Amen. Number 3, she poured out until there was nothing left. She poured into her neighbor's vessel. She didn't stop with one or two. She poured and poured until there was no more vessels left. See, we keep asking God for more and more when we haven't done anything with what He's already given us. Luke 6:38 says, "Give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaking together, running over, we be poured in your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you." This is talking about far more than just finances. This is talking about the giving of our time, our talents, our very lives to be poured out. And because of that pouring out, we can reap a harvest for God's glory. Pastor friend of mine, he was preaching a conference one time, and he had this bag of seed, and in this bag of seed, he took it, and he was pouring it out on the ground, and he says, "You know, I can take this bag of seed, and I can put it over my shoulder, and I can bring it to the harvest field, but once the harvest has come, I can't bring that harvest on one shoulder, or even two. It's going to take far more. See, the little bit that you sow, God can do far more, exceedingly abundantly above what you can ask or think." Philippians 2:15-17, the Apostle Paul says that you may become blameless, harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Hold fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the name of Christ, that I may have not run in vain or labored in vain. Yes, and if I am being poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. See, Paul didn't just preach or teach the word, but he loved and served and poured his very life out for the sake of the gospel. 1 Thessalonians 2:8, he said, "We were very well pleased to impart to you not only the gospel of God, but also our very own lives." Listen, do we really know what it means to pour out until there's nothing left, church? The fact is, many times we lack because we do not give. The way God works is He fills us so that we will pour out what He has given to us. Why would God fill us with His precious Holy Spirit only for us to squander it and hold it to ourselves? He fills you and empowers you so you can win a world for God. God wants to use us, but He pours in so we can pour out. You know, we as Southerns, we love our iced tea. But don't you just hate it when a person making it is just a little bit too stingy with the sugar? They only put just a little bit in. And everyone knows when you make tea, you need one of those 4-cup measure cups so you can pour out in abundance. But you know, it's the same with God. We want the blessings of God to flow into our lives, but we are content to do nothing for the kingdom of God. But God pours in so you can pour out an abundance. Listen, the only reason God will fill you with His Holy Spirit is not so you can speak in tongues and feel goosebumps go up and down your spine. He fills you so that you can be empowered to live this life for God and become an effective witness for Him to reach this world. See, this woman, she kept pouring. Vessel after vessel. She didn't stop. She didn't grow weary in well-doing. She says, "There's another vessel. Come on, bring another vessel, boys. We're going to pour some more." She didn't quit until there was not another vessel she could pour her oil into. And we cannot quit, church. We cannot quit. Even if it's at the very end of our lives. Paul, you read in the book of Acts, even till the day he died, was still pouring the life of God out into people. He knew he was about to be executed in Rome by Caesar. He knew what he was facing. But he says, "I'm going to keep fighting. I fought the good fight. I've kept the course. I've finished it. And now there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness." He says, "I'm going to keep pouring out. I'm going to pour out until there's nothing left. There's not another vessel. There's not another person that I can pour this life of God into." And lastly, because she admitted her need, and because she offered God the little she had, and because she was willing to pour out until there was nothing left, she was blessed beyond measure. Not only did she pay off her debt, she had enough to live on for years after that. Oh, listen, church, you will never know that God is all you need until He is all you have. And I believe that in the coming days, we're going to find that out more and more. We've relied so long on the comforts of this life in America. We have had such a comfortable life, but things are going to get difficult in the days ahead. We're going to face things. We're going to go through without certain things. We're going to need and look to the supernatural provision of God. But you'll find in those moments that God is all you need. See, when God got through, hear me, her problem was not that she didn't have enough oil. Her problem was that she didn't have enough containers to fill it in. She poured out, but there was more. She poured out, and there was more. She poured out, but there was still more. Ephesians 3:20, now to him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Psalms 31:19, how abundant are the good things that you have stored up for those who fear you, that you bestow in the sight of all on those who take refuge in you. Psalms 23, David describes, my cup overflows. Oh, listen, God doesn't do things halfway, church. When he pours out, he always overflows. He always gives in abundance. In Malachi, he says, try me now, says the Lord, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out such a blessing that you cannot contain it. Amen. Hallelujah. I heard a little old widow woman in Louisiana once say, money cannot buy what my Jesus supplies. Money cannot buy what my Jesus supplies. Listen, he's more than enough, church. And as I said, we're going to find that out more and more in these coming days. There's a persecution coming against the church of Jesus Christ. You mark it down. We're going to face things. We're going to be ostracized. We're going to go through some things. But through it all, if you stand, you will find that God is more than enough to bring you through whatever you face. I'm closing this morning. There's a story of a little girl. I love this story. Who went with her mom to an old-fashioned country store. And after her mom had paid for her purchase, the clerk invited the girl to go and help herself to a handful of candy that was in a jar. And the little girl held back and just kind of waited, and the clerk was surprised and asked, what's the matter? Don't you like candy? And the child nodded. So then the clerk put his hand in the jar, and he grabbed out a generous portion and put it in a bag and gave it to her. And when they got outside, the mother asked her daughter, she said, why, when that clerk invited you to grab candy, that you didn't grab it? She said, Mama, because his hands are a lot bigger than mine. She said, his hands are a lot bigger than mine. Oh, hear me this morning, church. God's hands are a lot bigger than yours. He can supply a lot more than you can try in your own effort to take. I said he could supply a lot more than you can try in your own effort to take. So what's in your house this morning? God doesn't need much to do much. So first admit your need. Offer what you have to God. Pour out until there's nothing left. And then watch as God can and will bless you beyond measure. What's in your house? What's in your house this morning, church? What are you facing? What knock did you receive at the door this week? There's things that can overwhelm us. But what God is saying to you, I'm all you need, church. I'm still all you need. I'm still all you need.